Welcome to the second part of this morning's lecture. By the way, the lecture was mostly following actually Leo's lecture notes for the alternating extraction proof. So this is the link to his notes, or you can just Google Raisin and Wolpert. That's the guy who took the scribes, and this will be the first hint. The girl who took the, sorry. Okay, we have to edit that out, otherwise I get. So let's also shortly go back to this proof that I showed you before for the delta plus epsilon, where you know I totally intentionally made the mistake and nobody except Udi catched it. And it's here. So I give you one more minute to think about what's wrong. So you remember, so that's what statement we wanted to show, so that S and extraction from, you know, if we have a delta close, a seed that is delta close to uniform, we extract, that's delta plus epsilon close to S and uniform. And let's see if this works. So we did this funny trick that we kind of subtracted the probability of U being X and added it back, so this was just equivalence. And here I took the absolute value, and then I could replace delta with 1. And then we got this here, and I claim that this is at most delta. What? It's what?
1/2.
No. What 1/2?
1/2 is missing.
Yeah. No, it's actually 2 is missing, right? So the point is this is 2 delta, which usually is not a big deal, but you know the entire point of this thing was to kind of show you how to get rid of the 2. So who has an idea how to fix this? So let's see. We want to upper bound this term here, right? So this term, so if you look just at this entire term here, if you just look at this here, so this is, sometimes this is negative, sometimes this is positive, right? So if we want to maximize it without loss of generality, we can assume that this delta here is always 0 whenever this is negative. Because if it's not, and I just do that, I will always increase the value. So, but if this is always 0, so then I can rewrite. So if we assume that this is the case, I can rewrite this as sum over x, where, let's say, but only the x where probability s equals x. This is s equals x is strictly bigger than. So instead of summing over all x, I only have to sum over kind of the ones where this is bigger than this one. So then all terms are positive. Now I can actually replace this delta with 1. And that's the statistical distance, because now I only count like half of the, right, half of this probability mass that was 2 delta in here. Now I only count half of it. Yeah? Let's switch gears. So this part of the lecture will be about the conditional chain rules, or the conditional chain rule for Hill entropy, and let me shortly recap what wording I want to use during this lecture, because it's going to be maybe slightly different than yesterday. So we saw that many entropy notions, in particular, arguably any notion of entropy, any kind of notion that somehow is measured the uncertainty contained in a variable, should satisfy something like a leakage rule, which roughly says the following. H is some kind of entropy measure, and we want to measure the entropy of X conditioned on some variable A. And this shouldn't be too small. Intuitively, what we want is that whenever we condition on something that is, say, L bits long, the entropy should drop by L. So this here just means the bit length of A. And we know that such a, let's call it leakage rule for now, such a leakage rule holds for all natural information theoretic notions, like for Shannon entropy, min entropy, and so on, even where this length of L can be replaced with something smaller, like H0 of A or things like that. And it also holds for many computational notions of entropy. In particular, yesterday, Leo showed you the rule for Hill entropy, which said the following. This is Hill. So if we start with the variable x that has, some amount of Hill entropy, say this x is indistinguishable from some variable y that has k bits of min entropy against distinguishers of size s. Right? So every distinguisher of size running in time s will have advantage at most epsilon in distinguishing this x from some other variable that has actually k bits of min entropy. And then I condition this on the variable a. Then the min entropy will indeed just drop by the length of this conditional part. So Leo showed a slightly different statement where this was like 1 divided by the probability of the conditional part taking some particular value. But this implies this easier to state but slightly less general rule. And what did we, so this is about the amount of entropy, right? So so if this is k bits of Hill entropy, we condition on L bits, what will be left will have k minus L bits of Hill entropy. So this is like the chain rule. But there is also this, this subscript, this S epsilon. So you remember how Hill entropy was defined. We said that x has k bits of Hill entropy if it's epsilon s indistinguishable from some variable having k bits of min entropy. And we had a degradation in these parameters, s prime epsilon prime. And there are dozens of different proofs that give you different epsilon prime s primes. So let's just for concreteness, one concrete one is, for example, epsilon prime is roughly epsilon. So we can keep the distinguishing advantage roughly unchanged. And we lose in the size of the distinguishers that we can tolerate. So if the original distribution was indistinguishable by distinguishers of size s, the new one will be roughly secure against distinguishers of size s times, we lose epsilon squared, and then we'll also lose something exponential in the length of the leakage. Right? So if the original, And you can, in fact, show that relative to some oracles, that loss is indeed necessary. Okay, so this is a leakage rule. And why do I call this a leakage rule and not a chain rule? Because I want to reserve this term for a slightly more general term, leakage chain rule. So if I talk about the leakage chain rule, what I mean by this is that I consider the same statement, but where we start with a variable x that has some entropy conditioned already on some other variable z. And in fact, this doesn't make much difference for most notions. Like for this condition, this leakage chain rule still holds for all information theoretic notions, Shannon entropy, min entropy, all kinds of Renyi entropies, computational notions like unpredictability entropy that you will see tomorrow, or Yau entropy, which is not a computational notion. But interestingly, it does not hold for, or it hasn't been known, and it's actually known to be wrong, for Hill. In particular, what goes wrong? So Leo yesterday shortly meant, yes?
So if there's like 2 bits of Hill, 2 n bits. But if you reveal A as the C, which is n bits.
Yes.
How intuitively even it should be?
Good question. So let's see. You have a seed of n bits. X is a PRG of that seed. And if you leak n bits, how much Hill should be left? Not much, right? Or let's say X is even like a gigabyte. Its output as a PRG on a 1,000 bit thing. So if I give you this 1,000 bits, this gigantic thing should basically drop to nothing. Is that true? Yeah, let's see what S becomes. The original PRG was secure because there's always brute forcing, right? So S could not have been possibly bigger than something like 2 to the 1,000, right? But now I lose, if the leakage is 1,000, I lose 2 to the 1,000. So you see it's kind of exactly. So this just shows that if you assume that, let's say, exponentially hard pseudorandom generators exist, ones where the best you can do is brute force the seed until you find it, this already shows that this loss is necessary. Because if I give you some bits of the seed, it will kind of allow you to shortcut things. Right? Good question. Okay. So if you remember the proof maybe from yesterday that Leo showed, where things went wrong, was that once you started with conditioning on some Z, all this argument that he had, you needed like for different choices of this conditional part, you needed like different thresholds and maybe even the sign kind of changed. So you could fix that, but you would have to hard code what to do for every possible seed. So what you would lose is here basically something like, you would basically lose something exponential in Z that you started with. In particular, you wouldn't get anything better than starting here with just replacing X conditional on Z just with X and then considering ZA to be the total leakage. You can do slightly better than, I think, matching, right? There is a loss with 2 times to the leakage. Something like times or plus here?
Minus.
What?
Minus. Smaller S. So minus.
What is minus?
Minus this term.
Yeah. Okay, not too bad. Sometimes even meaningful, but these are like very recent results that you can actually lose this set just additively, but still, not what we want. Because in many applications, this set is actually huge. Okay. So, and if I say many applications, let me just mention some, not applications, but what happened is people really wanted this chain rule for many, many applications. They never could prove it. So, but fortunately, in many applications, they found a kind of a workaround. So Leo showed you one yesterday for a deterministic encryption, which basically hinged on the fact that this conditional part was close to uniform, basically. And then so he was able to pull it through. Okay, and because I have actually a lot of time, because I thought that I would still be talking about leakage resilience at this point. Let me just restate the definition of Hill entropy, right? So I think it doesn't hurt if you see it again. So we said that X conditioned on Z has k bits of entropy if there exists some joint distribution YZ. So we use the same letter Z as above, which means that the marginal distribution of YZ and XZ, if we just look at the second part, is identically distributed, where this Y conditioned on Z has high min entropy. So this H, this tilde above, refers to the average case min entropy notion that Leo showed you yesterday. He didn't use the tilde, but it's often used because to not confuse it with the more historical notion of worst case conditional Hill entropy. But this is the right notion of conditional Hill entropy. And moreover, this high min entropy distribution Y is actually epsilon S indistinguishable from my Z. So what are these notions that people came up with in other applications? So this is conditional Hill entropy. So one is relaxed. Also, Leo mentioned this yesterday. And then relaxed entropy, what we change is we do not require that there exists a distribution YZ, where the marginal distribution of the second part is identical, but we just allow any Z prime. So there must be any distribution YZ prime. We still want Y conditioned on Z prime to be large. This is the same as before. And we also still want the indistinguishability property. So this stays the same. And this, you know, it's clear to see if you have a variable x, if x conditioned on z has k bits of Hill, epsilon s, what can you say about its relaxed entropy? It has the same. But the other direction is not true. Because, you know, z prime being equals to x is a special case, but it could, as we will see, it can really help to have this leverage. Yeah. And if your application is good enough, you know, with this notion, you're fine. I mean, you're fine using the leakage chain rule. That exists. Okay, decomposable. I think this is basically the same as modular Hill entropy that we saw yesterday. This kind of strengthens the notion of Hill in the sense that, you know, x conditioned on z having Hill entropy means that, you know, x is hard to distinguish from something with Hamiltonian entropy given z. And decomposable means it's even hard for any particular z. So for any particular z, you can have like a different prediction algorithm. So that so what we know for every z, so this replaces, so this rule here, so here we said x conditional z is k, here the starting statement is stronger. Here we want that for every particular choice of the conditional part. So let's, for example, take the example of, let's see, what could we take? So just to show you that it's not the same, let's see what is a natural example. Let's say x is again PRG on some input. Okay, so who sees a good distribution which has high decomposable but not high Hill entropy? I should have thought that up before. Any suggestions? Yeah. You showed it, yeah. Oh, you did it yesterday, yeah. So, so it's conditional.
Encryption based on, encryption conditioned on the public key, et cetera, you know, plaintext conditioned on public key, et cetera.
To make that?
Yeah. For plaintext conditioned on public key, et cetera.
Plaintext? M condition on encryption of message on some secret key and public key, yeah, things like that. Yeah, because for any particular public key, right, so for any particular public key, there exists a distinguisher, you know. For any particular public key, there exists a distinguisher that, you know, given the ciphertext tells you if this is M or something different, because for every particular public key, there exists a secret key, so I can decrypt this and check. On the other hand, if this is just like a random public key, and this is like a ciphertext under that with the corresponding secret key, and they give you the message, you will not be able to distinguish the encrypted message from something uniform. So this is really a much, this decomposable notion is really a much less useful notion also. Even though it looks like a conditional notion, basically it says it has Hill entropy unconditionally because it's like piecewise high in Hill entropy conditioned on every part. And then there is a notion that has been used by Samplable called Samplable Hill entropy. So this notion has been used by Kalai, Ras, and I forgot the third author, for also a very nice application on something that is called memory delegation schemes. So they also would have liked to have a chain rule for conditional Hill entropy. They didn't, but they had like one extra property, namely they had this distribution. You see, there was this distribution yz, where y had high min entropy given z, and they had like one extra property, namely this y was efficiently samplable given z. Right, so that's just an extra property you can require from this yz property. So it means that whenever I give you the z part, there exists some algorithm that takes this set and maybe random coins and outputs a sample of y, so that this, you know, this distribution of the output of the sampler with z is, you know, let's say at least statistically close to this yz distribution, which has high mean entropy, is computation distinguishable. Okay, so what do we know? Decomposable and samplable seem to be incomparable. Yeah. Yeah, pseudo-randomness. So if let's say x is like if it's maximal. So x, if let's say x is pseudo-random, conditioned on z, so it has maximal hill. So y would be the uniform distribution, and the uniform distribution is efficiently samplable. There are more interesting ones, but I can't. But the uniform distribution is actually important already, right? Because it means that if you start with something that is close to uniform, conditioned on stuff, you actually do get the conditional chain. And that was actually, I think actually that was the setting in which they used it also. So lots of esoteric notions. So decomposable, if you have k bits of decomposable Hill entropy, you have k bits of the normal Hill entropy. Also samplable implies the same amount of Hill entropy. Decomposable and samplable, I think, are incomparable. Normal Hill implies relaxed Hill. And funny enough, so if let's go back to this leakage chain rule. This leakage chain rule has been proven for all these variants of Hill entropy except for the standard one. So with all these extra, these stronger notions, these weaker notions, it was true in the standard one. And what I want to show you, like in the next hour, is that actually, in fact, the standard one is wrong. And I will take quite a detour. In fact, I will show it you the same way we figured it out. And the way we figured it out was working on something totally different, namely deniable encryption. So what's deniable encryption? Has been proposed by Canetti, Dvorak, Naor in 96. So it's one of these notions that is around for like 2 decades now and has been annoying people for pretty much as long as it's around, because it's arguably a natural notion and people couldn't neither prove that it exists nor that it doesn't exist. And and before I tell you what is or what isn't known, let me define it. Basically, deniable encryption is defined the same way as public key encryption. So you have a sender. Let's see. He gets a security parameter. So let me make that explicit. So there is a security parameter n that he gets in unary. And he gets a bit b. We will just encrypt one bit. That will be sufficient for the sake of this argument. And we have a receiver. OK, he just gets the same security parameter. Now the receiver and the sender, like in a public key scheme, both of them can use random coins. And let me also make this explicit. So the sender initially samples random coins RS. The receiver will sample random coins RR that they will use for this protocol. Then they can talk for a few rounds if they want, like back and forth, right? And at the end of the day, the receiver has to output the bit B prime. And what properties do we want from such a sender deniable encryption scheme? So we will have three parameters. We will say that this scheme is epsilon n delta n tn sender deniable if the following is true. So just to look ahead, epsilon n and delta n will be just security parameters, which we want to be negligible for in n. And for any and t will be the running time, basically, or the security against what distinguishes we want to be secure. So for any polynomial t, at the end of the day, we want epsilon n and delta n to be negligible. So it's like standard security parameters. But it will be important to keep them explicit here. So we want correctness. Now, in standard encryption scheme, public encryption schemes, we usually want perfect correctness. We want that if nobody interfered with the communication, the receiver should output exactly the bit that the sender put in. Here, necessarily, we will have to relax this a little bit. So what we require is that the bit that that the bit that the receiver outputs at the end is equivalent to the bit that we kind of put in that the sender got to start with, is the same with probability at least, you know, epsilon close to 1. So if epsilon is very small, negligible, that's, you know, as good as perfect correctness. Security. Also, this property is defined the same way as for standard public key encryption schemes. So let me call this distribution here, let me call this transcript input B, RS, RR. Right? So once we fix the bit B, the randomness of sender and receiver, the entire transcript is fixed. So let me just call it like TB, RS, RR. And let me define TB to be the random variable that takes us, you know, the random variable that takes us values these transcripts for, you know, uniform choices of the randomness for the sender and the receiver. Right? Is that clear what this variable? So what does security mean for a standard encryption scheme? Basically, Eve, who kind of sees this transcript, should not be able to distinguish transcripts that kind of transfer a zero from transcripts that transfer a one. So security simply means delta t. So what they want is for any adversary Eve who runs in time t and she sees this transcript, she cannot distinguish the case where this was a zero bit or a one bit that was kind of communicated in that case, except with advantage delta. So again, if delta is negligible, that's kind of the standard notion. Now comes the, okay, so far everything just standard public key encryption schemes or bit agreement schemes, I should say. Now comes the interesting probability, deniability. So this is the extra property that has the, or sender deniability, I should say. But let me mention, if we have a sender deniable schemes, you can also get a receiver deniable scheme at like at the cost of having one extra round in communication. So without loss of generality, sender deniability. And this basically means the following. It means that if, you know, the local mafia guy comes to the sender with the gun and he says, listen, I saw the communication that you sent some bits to the receiver. And I think you were talking about me. Show me what you communicated. So Alice has to kind of open all the randomness and all the bits that she sent over to the receiver. And what deniability means is that she can lie about that. Or formally, there exists some cheating algorithm, let's call it phi. And the algorithm has the following property. Assume the bit B is for any uniform random bit. So if the bit is uniformly random, and you know, the randomness of the sender and receiver was also correctly sampled. So let C denote the transcript. So now C is a random variable. So this faking algorithm phi will take as input, so the bit B that was sent, the randomness of the sender, so that's, you know, Alice, she's shaking because there's the mafiosi, she has her randomness and the bit that she sent, and the transcript. So this is all information that the sender has. You apply this cheating algorithm, and it outputs you some new randomness, R prime S. And this R prime S has a fun property. It looks like the authentic randomness, but for the opposite bit. So what we want is that what happened is Alice chose a bit B, chose randomness RS, and you know there was this transcript C. The mafiosi saw the transcript C, comes to Alice and says, what bit did you send? And she would like to lie. She wants to convince him that it was 1 minus B. So there exists this, you know, there exists this faking algorithm that allows her to take the bit B, the randomness R, the transcript C, and kind of come up with fake randomness such that this looks exactly, you know, exactly computationally distinguishable from having sent the bit 1 minus B. Of course, the mafiosi can say, you know, it's kind of suspicious that you use deniable encryption in the first place, but you know, maybe that's how the communication with the bank or so was specified. She had to use it, so she did everything honestly. And she, you know, it's deniable. There is like no way she can you know, there is no way the mafiosi can know if she really is honest and shows him what she sent, or if she actually was using this this cheating algorithm. And this can also be actually useful if the sender is not really. Right. I should say maybe. So this looks like a terribly useful notion. It, you know, would be, it's natural. It would be nice to have, but you know, there are some caveats. For example, if we would allow the sender to just delete, if the protocol specifies that you have to delete things, you can get deniability quite trivially. So it's not, it's maybe not as useful as it looks like, but it's still you know, a very natural thing to have, and at the, maybe not to have, but to know if it exists or not and if you can construct it or not. So any questions to this definition so far? So as said, this was defined 20 years. Yeah?
What's known about it? Like, so for example, the interaction, is it possible to be symmetric?
Okay, actually, what is possible? It's possible, okay, so there are a few things known. So if you allow, if you can, if the protocol allows erasures, it's possible. If you know, if the sender can just, because the sender can just delete the randomness. And then basically what the sender would have to say is, I don't know anything. I sent this message and I don't keep my randomness. So trivial, right? Another thing that is known is it's possible if epsilon, I think epsilon, oh no, if delta. If delta is rough, so 1 over polynomial. If roughly delta is 1 divided by the communication complexity. So you can have a deniable scheme where, you know, the sender and Alice exchange theta of n bits. And then this delta will be 1 over theta of n. It's also maybe good enough for many applications. And then there is something else known. So if there's, so here we assume that the sender actually uses the correct encryption algorithm for the communication. You can, it's quite easy to come up with schemes where we have like two encryption algorithms, an honest one and a fake one, or a cheating one. Now if the sender uses the cheating one, he can later easily lie about having sent something different with respect to the honest encryption algorithm. So if you kind of know that you want to lie late, you can, but this is not clear how useful this is, right? So if the mafiosi comes and he will assume that you use the cheating one to start with, you kind of back with this problem. So that's kind of what has been known up to like 2 years ago. Not much, actually, right? So if this is possible or not was kind of in particular open. And there have been, there has even been a Eurocrypt paper that, there have been papers constructing these things, but all of them were flawed. In particular, there was a Eurocrypt paper that had a famously flawed proof, which actually we used, I won't show you that, but actually this was the first counterexample, counterexample based on one-way functions we had was actually on based on their flawed proof, because it was still good enough for the counterexample, but not good enough for deniable encryption. Okay. So. Good. So how, you know, how does pseudoentropy and things mean entropy or entropies come in into the picture when we talk about deniable encryption? So you see, correctness is not perfect, and you can already see immediately that this is necessary, right? Because if correctness was perfect, this means that, what does that mean? If correctness was perfect, this means that no matter what randomness I choose, the transcript will be just consistent with one possible bit. It's not possible that there are two different randomnesses that are consistent with the transcript for two different bits, because that immediately means that there must be some decryption error, because you could have chosen either of those choices of randomness. So there's going to be like a decryption error, but we want this to be negligible. And let's cast this like in terms of the choice, possible choices of randomness for the sender. So assume, okay, so assume you observe the transcript C. Now let this space here, R, let's call this RC, let this be all the choices of local randomness for the sender that is consistent consistent with C. So what does this mean? If I'm the mafiosi, I get this randomness, I see this challenge, I can see, yeah. So for all the, you know, I would have answered the outgoing messages from the sender as in this transcript, given that this was my concrete randomness. And not only do I want this to be consistent with C, I also want this to be choices of randomness where there's no decryption error. So this is going to be the choices of RS. where the sender chooses a random string, a bit B, sends it over to the receiver, and the receiver will decrypt, and he will actually get the correct answer. Decryption error. Right? And let's define another set. Let's call, let me draw it inside here. RC prime, prime, which is defined the same way, but now we have a decryption error. So these are the choices of randomness that the sender could have chosen to encrypt the bit B, such that is consistent with the transcript, but where the receiver actually would have decrypted wrong. So the same as before, and decryption error. So having said that, what does the faking algorithm do? So remember the faking algorithm. So maybe to correct, this was some correct, that the faking algorithm would take some randomness here, and also the bit that was encrypted. Maybe this is randomness that correctly encrypted the bit, and it would map it to some new randomness that decrypts to the wrong bit. So it would somehow map this RS to RS prime in here. And then we can apply the cheating algorithm again. So it would actually jump to here, then it has to jump somewhere out again, and so on. So if you just apply feedback and forth. That's pictorially how we can think what this cheating algorithm does. And now I can actually specify the decryption error, which was, remember this was epsilon, in terms of the sets RC and RC prime. Because what is the decryption error? The decryption error is the probability that, you know, that I picked, so first of all, I will assume that this picture looks the same for every possible transcript, just for the sake of this talk. It could be that for some transcripts, the decryption error differs, or that there are more choices of random strings, but let's assume for every possible transcript, the picture of good and bad random strings that decrypt correct and wrong is roughly like this. So then I can say the decryption error basically means that I pick a random point in this big circle, and I have a decryption error on the side of the receiver if I fall into this small circle, R prime C. So decryption error in terms of this set is simply the probability that I fall into this set, so the size of the set, divided by this, you know, by the set of the entire thing. And as said, we want the decryption error to be at most epsilon. Right, so, yes?
As we said, if you play P again, the move, it's not really because the B is, I mean, P is defined for, I mean, you fix the B, right?
Yes.
It's the same picture, but not really the same.
So then you get here, and here this would be phi 1 minus B, so the RS prime that we got here, and so on. And then you would get the RS double prime that is back then, and so on. Yes?
Yeah? So the randomness that's sorted by 5, is delta so much smaller set than the total possible randomness?
The what?
The set of possible outputs by 5 for a given transcript and a bit.
It kind of has to map this big thing to a small thing, right? And it's deterministic. So.
But isn't that like already bad as a definition? Because it can't be the mafia guy then just pick a few random coins and see that it outputs something different than what the randomness given by the sender?
No, so he cannot know what the correct output is. So the mafiosi guy and the sender does not know what the receiver decrypted. We just have a guarantee for the sender that if he picks randomness uniformly at random, the decryption error is epsilon. But you will never know if the first thing you picked was in this big circle or the small circle. Somehow, right? And because otherwise we could get the decryption error to zero. If I as a sender know that there is going to be decryption error with that randomness, I would just resample. So inherently, you're not allowed to know that otherwise. Okay, but that's, okay, so this is like an important observation. Why is it important? Because it means that the set RC of good random strings has to be sufficiently bigger than the set of, in particular, this basically means that RC has to be at least something like R prime, or let's even, let me take log RC prime times log 1 over epsilon, something like that. And this
plus,
yeah, because we took the log, so it's plus. So because it's log, it's plus. And this has to be omega log n, so super logarithmic, because we wanted epsilon to be negligible. So that's basically what I meant, epsilon is negligible. It has to be 2 to the, epsilon has to be smaller than 1 over any polynomial, which is equivalent to say that log 1 over epsilon has to be grow super logarithmically. Okay. And this observation will already be enough to kind of give you a counterexample to the conditional chain rule. So what are the distributions? So now I give you the distributions, and then we will see that I give you a distribution, you know, A conditioned on B, and show late. So I will show you that this has like some kind of Hill entropy against really high quality Hill entropy, cryptographic against, you know, any polynomial adversary, negligible distinguishing advantage, and lots of it. And then I will condition just on a single bit, and it will, you know, destroy a lot of it, even if we condition much, even if we consider much, much weaker distinguishers. So it will be very, very frustrating, kind of like. Okay, so here is the distribution. I pick a random bit B, so uniformly random bit B. Right? Okay, I pick uniform randomness for the sender. I pick uniform randomness for the receiver. So this is just what I picked so far. Then I compute something. Let me compute the transcript that corresponds to these values. Right, so I have a bit that I want to send, sender randomness, receiver randomness, so on. And okay, something that I should mention here. I picked the randomness for the sender so that the receiver decrypts correctly. So with a very small probability, I have to resample. But basically, it's RS is almost uniform. It's epsilon close to uniform. But it will make the argument slightly more cleaner if we assume that RS and RR are chosen in a way that there is no decryption error. Then I apply my cheating algorithm to this set. Right, now I have a bit B. I have the randomness. I have a transcript. And I call this new variable RS prime. Okay. So what can I say about these variables? So I claim that this RS prime has high Hill entropy given C. In particular, what I claim is that this R prime S is computationally indistinguishable, like delta T indistinguishable, from the uniform distribution on this entire space. I claim this is indistinguishable from the uniform distribution on what? On this, let me introduce this notation. So this is a set, right? So this is a set of all the possible choices of the random strings for the sender. Oh, and actually, I assumed that it's a correct one. Oh, this doesn't matter, actually. So I claim that this string is indistinguishable from the uniform distribution on this huge set. And why is it? Yeah, that's the deniability probability, right? So if you could distinguish, so I pick the, you know, a random string RS. I use the lying algorithm. I got something else. But if you could distinguish this from the uniform distribution on this set, you could kind of tell that I cheated. You could say that this, you know, this doesn't look like a uniformly chosen, this doesn't look like a uniformly chosen RS prime. But we explicitly assume it is, and in particular, we assume it's delta t indistinguishable from a uniform chosen. And this is true conditioned on the transcript. Right? So that simply directly follows from the definition of deniability. So, but what does that mean? This, of course, means by definition that the Hill entropy of R prime S conditioned on C is at least, you know, uh, So R prime C, condition on C, is indistinguishable from some variable with very high mean entropy, namely the variable that is uniform on this set. And the variable that is uniform on this set has, you know, log size of this set, so log size of this set mean entropy, right? So it has a lot of mean entropy. So now, who sees how to, I give you one bit. You can condition on one extra bit, and I want you to destroy a lot of this nice Hill entropy. So now, there is this R prime S, there is this C that everyone sees, and I can kind of pretend it's, you know, it's one of those many strings here in this world. So now you can give, somebody, there can be like a hardcore spoiler, just like one bit that kind of destroys a lot of it. So what should you tell me to kind of ruin this? What? B. Yeah. So now what happens if somebody comes with, what can we say about the Hill entropy of R prime S, condition on C, and the one single bit B? I think I don't write this up. I think I have to improve. Oh, yeah. I have notes for that. Good. What I claim is that, yeah. I claim, yeah, once I condition on this bit B, I claim the Hill entropy gets down, let's say to log. So first of all, you see, this is the set, the small set, right? So this is the set of, this is the set here that was a factor, you know, epsilon of the big set. So in particular, it has log 1 over epsilon bits less of Hill entropy. So what about the quality here? You know, to make the counterexample even stronger, I would like to be this even of much worse quality than this. And I claim that, you know, here I can replace delta, say, with any constant smaller than 1. I give you 1/2. So, like, huge distinguishing advantage. And against some small fixed polynomial size distinguisher. And in fact, the only thing this distinguisher will have to do is to run the, you know, given a transcript, verify that a transcript is consistent with some given random string. And because, you know, it's a deniable encryption, has to be efficient. So this is going to be some small fixed polynomial. So why is that true? So I think the first statement I'm not going to prove, I think this follows from definition. Let's prove this one. So the proof is by contraposition. Assume not. Assume there exists some, you know, some y that has, you know, high mean entropy. So the mean entropy of y given CB is really bigger than log. Right. So this is some kind of distribution on strings that is at least one bit bigger than the uniform distribution on this string. What does it mean it's one bit bigger? So the Hill entropy is one bit bigger, which means, the mean entropy is one bit bigger, which means that, okay, we will only talk about flat distributions. So we will, so this helps it. So this y must look something like this. So maybe this y contains all the strings r prime s. That's actually a clever thing to do if you want to, you know, if you want to be as indistinguishable from as possible from the uniform distribution on one r prime C, sorry. So let's take all this, but let's take additionally something, I don't know. So this is y. And this y is more than, this y is slightly more than twice as big as this thing, which means that with probability more than 1/2, if I pick something according to the distribution of y, with probability more than 1/2, I will land outside of this set RC prime. Right? But if I land outside of the set RC prime, I can actually, you know, a distinguisher can immediately tell that this is not a sample from RC prime because it gets the string. It's inconsistent with C. So either it's inconsistent with C, that's when you land here, or it's consistent with C, but, you know, but not for this bit B, but for the opposite, B minus 1. That's when it's actually landed in RC. So there is a distinguisher that can distinguish Y from any distribution, so with probability 1/2, can distinguish y from the distribution of r prime s. So what does that mean? Should I write this up? Okay, I'm not going to write that, but this proves it, right? So I have a contrapunto. So it's not true that there exists a distinguisher which probability 1/2 can't be distinguished from the uniform distribution on RC prime by a polynomial size distinguisher, because I give you this distinguisher. The distinguisher takes the sample, checks if it's consistent with the bit 1 minus b and the transcript c, and says, no, I think this is a distribution of y, not the other one, whenever this is not consistent, and this distinguisher, because y falls outside of RC prime with probability strictly more than 1/2, so it will be inconsistent with, it will be successful, the distinguishing probability will be strictly more than 1/2. Okay? So summing up, what did that show? So I showed you a variable such that I showed you a joint distribution of three variables, namely R prime S, CB, such that the decrease in Hill entropy of conditioning on this additional extra bit B is large, namely it's at least log 1 minus epsilon minus 1. Okay, whatever. So it was large. It was omega log N if we assume that epsilon was negligible. And not only that, also kind of the decrease in quality was massive, right? So here we had like cryptographic strength in distinguishability, and for this, after conditioning on this extra bit, we don't even have Hill entropy against like really, really weak fixed polynomial size distinguishers that kind of have constant distinguishing advantage. Okay, so where do I gonna want to go from here? Because we still have actually more time than expected. Yes? Exactly. So this was actually, this presentation follows the historical development of this thing. And the reason was what happened. So we looked into deniable encryption. We realized that. Then we got really excited because then we thought, okay, now let's prove the conditional chain rule for Hill entropy, and we killed this object once and for all, right? So but then we actually realized it's actually not the deniable encryption. That's the problem. The chain was actually wrong. And I will show you now a counterexample just from one-way functions. So once you know it's wrong, you can actually find all kinds of counterexamples based on all kinds of assumptions. In fact, the weakest assumption we need is that NP is not NP poly. Then we get the counterexample, although it's not efficiently samplable, the distributions anymore, but you can get it from very weak assumptions. And actually, half a year later, after we had this counterexample, actually there came the first non-broken candidate constructions for deniable encryption based on IO, indistinguishability obfuscation. So now if you had to bet, it's probably it exists. Probably deniable encryption exists. And the chain rule, conditional chain rule for Hill entropy is almost certainly wrong, unless you believe, P equals NP, it's almost certainly wrong. In which case, all these things become void because then Hill entropy is the same as min entropy, then it's true. But, okay. So counterexample from one-way functions. In fact, I will not do it from one-way functions, but slightly stronger objects, namely injective one-way functions. So injective one-way functions are functions where every input x maps to a different value, so there are no collisions. And I don't even want to start from injective one-way functions, but from something even stronger, namely perfectly binding bit commitments. Which we know how to construct from injective one-way functions, as I okay, so what is, so I will now show you a definition of a perfectly binding bit commitment scheme. I will shortly sketch to you how to construct one from any injective one-way function, and then we construct the counterexample from this commitment scheme. So maybe, okay, so who knows what a bit commitment is, or commitment schemes? I think if you had the crypto, okay, so let me go fast. So it's a function that takes a bit and it's probabilistic and perfectly binding. So it's a function. This color is a bit annoying, huh? What do you want, blue? So this commitment function com takes a bit, b, some random string r, probabilistic, and output something. And the perfectly binding property that we will need says that whenever the output of the commitment is the same, so if this was the commitment, then the input was the same. And in fact, I need a strong notion of perfectly binding. Typically, you only require B to be the same. You don't care about the R's. I will need a stronger notion where it's kind of unique. So there are no two random strings for the same bit that kind of map to the same. This will be convenient for the counter example, and we can construct these things easily from injective one-way functions, as I showed you. Right? So in particular, this means, so once you see the commitment, there is no way to open it to two different bits. In fact, I can even open it to two different choices of randomness, which will be useful for us, but it's usually not required. It's computationally hiding. What does that mean? It means that so Rn is just a uniform random string whose length depends on the security parameter n. So we want this to be kind of computationally indistinguishable from a commitment of 1, right? Even though those distributions are clearly disjoint, as implied by the perfect binding property, we want them to be computationally distinguishable. So how to construct such a commitment is also a little detour. Assume f is an injective one-way function. How to construct such a perfectly binding commitment from an injective one-way function. Here is the construction. To commit to a bit b using randomness, which really have two parts, s and x, you do the following. The commitment is, you know, the s part of the randomness, which you give, you apply f to the input x. And then the last part is b x ort with the inner product of s and x. So tomorrow you will see a definition of hardcore bits. So if f is a one-way function, x is uniform, and s is random and public, you can show that the inner product of s and x is a hardcore bit. So this will be indistinguishable, computationally distinguishable from random, given f, x, and s. So then I can, and you know, once I have this pseudo-random bit here, I can use it like a one-time path to kind of blind this committed bit b. So this shows the hiding property. Why is it computationally perfectly binding? Because f is injective. So there is, given f of x, there is just one choice of x. And you know, once x is fixed, like this thing is also fixed, then there is only one way in which I can open this commitment. OK. So now how to construct like a distribution, a, b, c, that kind of contradicts the conditional, the leakage chain rule. So again, let me give the distribution, and then we will show these properties that it has high Hill entropy, but then if you condition on one extra bit b, it's again going to bit b, which we sample uniformly at random, then it will massively drop. Okay. So we sample this bit b, and we sample 3n random strings for our commitment schemes. So this is just the, you know, random 3n random strings for the commitment scheme. And n is some security parameter. Actually, not security. So n is okay, n is whatever you want, actually. So the gap that we will get in the Hill entropy is going to be, so we will get n bits of Hill entropy for one distribution, and we condition on one bit, and it goes down from n to 0. And the length of all the variables and everything will be polynomial in n. OK, so now let me define a variable x as follows. So we simply commit to 3n bits. So first, we commit to the bit b, I think, yeah. R1, R2, and so on, up to. So we commit n times to the bit b, and 2n times to the opposite bit. So far, nothing special, right? So I chose a bit b, I commit n times to the bit b, 2n times to the bit 1 minus b, and then to kind of hide which bit is where, I kind of sort these 3n strings. I sort or randomly permute, doesn't matter, kind of I don't. And this sorted list of commitments, and sorting means it's a commitment. I think of these commitments as a bit string, as a number, and I sort them lexicographically. Right? So this basically is just there to hide which of the commitments commit to b and which commit to 1 minus b. So this is my variable x. Okay, so what can I say about this variable x? And then, okay, I define another variable z, and z is going to be the randomness used to commit to the first n bits. So I have this, you know, 3n commitments, n of them commit to the bit b, and this randomness for this n commitments is called z. That's just a random variable. Okay. So what? Let's check some facts. What do we know about the min entropy, say, of z conditioned on x? I give you x, you're computationally unbounded. This we talk about min entropy. But if you're computationally unbounded, then it's like a perfectly binding commitment, and so you can compute b and r, because remember that we said that the commitment is injective. So you can compute all these b's and all these r's, and then you will see, okay, so one, you will figure out b, because there are 2n, only n of them commit to the bit b, 2n commit to the other bit. Then you pick those n random strings that were used for this commitment, and then you're good. So this is 0. Is clear? So this is just, okay.
You don't know the order of R1, R2, R3, for
example? Let's say they are also sorted, just to avoid kind of you have no freedom of choice in which sort. In which order you, okay. Yeah. Let's see, what else do we know? Let's see. What do we know about the Hill entropy of Z conditioned on X and B? So what does it mean? So maybe I tell you what this, I claim that this is also gonna be basically zero. So what does that mean? That means that I know x and b. I know this. Maybe I'm computationally very bounded, but I know x and b. And now you come to me and you claim that, look, there is this variable which has non-trivial min entropy, and you cannot distinguish any sample of this variable from this correct R1 to Rn string. But that's not possible, because I can distinguish, so here is the observation. I can distinguish given x and b, I can distinguish R1 to Rn from any other variable very efficiently. Why? Because, I have my 3n commitments. I just kind of check which randomness belongs to which one. I open them. I see if really all these n commitments commit to b. And there is only one string. Yeah, there's only one string of R1 to Rn which will kind of succeed this test, simply because the commitment is injective. So just by construction, there is simply no freedom I have here. Is this clear? So should I write this out or? I claim this is basically zero, even against very weak adversaries. Say, even if I just want to have 1/2 here and poly here. But let's go to the interesting case. If I don't, so now I did it the other way around, right? So I showed you that with the bit b, there is nothing. Once you know which bit b was committed where, I can verify. So, but without this bit. So let me use a blackboard for this. So assume you see this commitment, so this variable, what was it, x, right? So this variable x, these are commitments, c1, c2, c3, c4, c5, c6 maybe. You just see three n commitments, n is 2 here. Some of them, so there was a bit b, let's say for concreteness it was the bit 0. n of them, so 2, so this will some r thing. Let's call it R3. It's not the same subscript as there. So 2 of them will be for the bit B. Let's maybe these 2. Right? Whereas the other ones will be for the bit commitments to the bit 1 minus B. Right? So this will be a commitment. Okay. So we have these 6 commitments. And 2 of the commitments, and there's a bit B, which is 0. 2 of the commitments, let's say these 2, are commitments to the bit 0. I just write 0. And the other ones are commitments to the bit 1 minus b, so it's going to be the bit b1. And b is for this concreteness for the bit b0. So this is a variable x. Remember, 3n commitments, n of them to the bit b, 2n of them to the other. Then I sort them, so this will, you know, they will be kind of hidden, the 0 commitment. So as I said before, if somebody gives me this x, that's not going, okay. Actually, it was convenient to see this. wait, now I need to go. Where did I have this? Okay, so it's C. Exactly. And what is z? Remember, z was the randomness in these 2 commitments, right? So this was R, maybe call this R1, and maybe this was R2, or maybe it was the other way around. So this was this randomness. Now, if you know the bit B, if you know this is 0, then you can, you know, I can distinguish R1, R2 from any other distribution by simply checking, right? So I get R1, R2, I have the bit B, and I simply check if this randomness, I apply the randomness I have, I look, you know, I commit to the bit 0 using this randomness, and I check if these are these 2. If these 2 commitments are somewhere, I don't know where they are, but they must be somewhere there. And I know that there are only 2 of them because I got the correct bit B. So this was the first statement. And the other statement, that if I do not know B, I claim that the Hill entropy of z, the Hill entropy of this, you know, of the randomness used to commit to the bit b, given this commitments from 1 to 3n, is very high. And to prove this, I have to come up with a distribution that you cannot distinguish, you know, from this distribution. It's actually not a distribution. It's actually just one possible value. And my new distribution needs to have a high entropy. So what could this distribution be? So how can you fool me if I don't know B? So what would be Y? So you have to come up with the Y such that Y, comma X is indistinguishable from Z, comma X. And moreover, this Y should have a high, you know, high support. So it should be high mean entropy. I can already tell you it's going to be more than n. So there should be exponentially many possibilities for this fake choice. Yeah, exactly. So if I don't know B, right, somebody could come to me and say, look, pretend that B was 1, not 0. I'm not going to be able to distinguish by the hiding property of the commitment scheme. He says, look, B was 1, I promise. And OK, so there are going to be two commitments to 1 hidden somewhere here. Actually, he's lying, because he was lying about the B. There is not just 2, there are 4. Or there are not just n, there are 2n. So then he kind of says, look, I give you this randomness and this randomness. And I say, yeah, that looks perfectly fine. Right? If B really was 1, you give me these 2 randomness, I kind of think, you know, I commit to the bit 1 using this randomness, and it looks good. Or he could give me this randomness here and the randomness here. Or this one and this one. Or this one and this one. And you get the idea. So how many choices does he have? There are 2n commitments to the bit 1 minus b. He can't give me any n of them. So this y can be uniform over a set of size 2n choose n, which, if we take the log, is going to be at least n, right? So I claim the that the uniform distribution over these more than exponent 2 to the n possible pairs or n tuples of randomnesses to do the commitment is computationally indistinguishable from the from this pair if you don't know b. So this you can prove by a hybrid argument using the hiding property of the commitment scheme. And once you prove that, so you know, we have established this distribution y with high min entropy that is indistinguishable from z, and we've shown that x condition on z has high kill. So maybe we should kind of, probably it needs a while to, you know, we only, you know, this counterexample, it takes a while to get your head around it, and we only found it once we knew that the hill, that the chain rule is probably wrong, and then you kind of. So what is going on here? Basically, you have this set of commitments. The variable you're interested in is an opening of n of them to some bit b that you know is either 0 or 1. And this bit b, you know, once you know this bit b, there is only one possibility of, you know, of n commitments that you can open. But if you don't know this bit b, you can be easily fooled. In fact, there are exponentially many choices to open n commitments to the opposite bit, and you can't distinguish these two cases. So there is lots of min entropy in this variable that is the opening of the correct n commitments. But once somebody gives you a bit b, he tells you which of the commitments appear only n times, not 2n times, then all this choice is gone. So this kind of, I think that's the most important thing to understand, so that there is in the computational setting, it's really possible to just give you one bit that really destroys all this beautiful hill entropy that is out there. Okay, so that was everything I wanted to say about, you know, the counterexample for hill entropy. And we have 15 minutes, so what I could do in the last 15 minutes is, actually let me do that. So are there questions so far? So we have a lot of time for questions. Or otherwise, I sketch you another construction. So I go back to last hour, I sketch you another construction of a leakage resilient stream cipher, which is actually much even simpler than the one we saw before, which is not based directly on the chain rule for hill entropy, but okay, it uses in the proof, but more on something that Yevgeny told us about, namely that weak PRFs are secure even in a model where the keys come from a non-uniform distribution. So let me do the other thing. Huh? No question. Okay, good. Okay, so what is a weak PRF? So I think all of you probably know the definition of a pseudo-random function. It's like a family of functions which is indexed by some key k, and it has the following property: if the key is chosen uniformly at random, an adversary who can query the function on inputs of its choice cannot distinguish the output of this function from the outputs of a uniformly random function. Right? That's a PRF. Now, okay, so a PRF f, if the key k is chosen uniformly at random, then an adversary, you know, an adversary asking queries cannot tell if this is, you know, cannot tell if he gets back the PRF queries or something uniformly random. Now it's natural to ask, you know, in the leakage resilient crypto setting, what happens if the adversary gets like maybe one bit of information about the key? If an adversary gets one bit of information about the key, say we have some leakage function f, and the one bit of information that the adversary leaks is going to be the first bit of the PRF f on with key k on input 0, say. If you get this one bit of information, the security of the PRF is totally gone, because now I can distinguish the PRF from uniform simply by querying it on input 0, see if the first bit of the output is consistent with what I got as leakage, and I have, like, even with just one bit of leakage, I get distinguishing advantage 1/2. Right? Okay. So that's a PRF. So what is a weak PRF? A weak PRF is, you know, also like an exponential family of functions that's indexed by a key, but the security experiment is defined differently. Now, the security experiment is defined as follows. So, you know, the key K is chosen uniformly at random. And so in the PRF game, right, the adversary chose X and then he got back either FK of X or, you know, R is a random function and he had to distinguish these two things. And in the weak PRF game, we slightly changed the experiment. Now the input X is not chosen by the adversary, but it's actually, it's also chosen at random. And no, the input is chosen uniformly at random for the adversary, and then the adversary has to, you know, again, distinguish the output of the PRF from a uniformly random output of uniformly random function. Okay, this is not, the game is not very well shown, but you get the idea. And what is important here is that this attack that I showed you before doesn't work anymore. Because now if I get the key K and I can leak something, what can I leak? So let's say I leak again the first bit of F on input 0. But now I play the weak PRF game, and if if the domain of the PRF is sufficiently large, typically it's, you know, 256 bits or something like that, you know, exponentially large with some security parameter, there is no chance that, you know, the random inputs I get are going to hit this, you know, are going to be equal to 0 or whatever other output I chose during the leakage function. So there is some hope that, you know, such a function f is still indistinguishable from random if queried on random inputs, even given some leakage about the key K. And in fact, that's what Evgeny actually mentioned last time. He showed the following. So if F is a, you know,
the weak PRF, I mean, without leak, it's just trivial, right? So if you have a PRF, it's trivial to use a weak PRF.
Of the key. And what you lose is basically, okay, you lose something exponential in the key length, which is not surprising. Just, you can show that this has to be, right? You have to lose something. Yeah? Okay, there is also a square root here. So, and you kind of lose a factor of 2 in the number of queries. So it's, this is going to be a weak PRF against one random query when, if you had 2 queries here. More generally, if you have 2k queries here, you will get k queries here. So this is just kind of recapping what Yevgeny said 2 days ago. And how can we use this to construct a leakage resilient stream cipher? So here's the idea. So we take a PRF, F, which we know is also a weak PRF, like F. And we do something very similar like the stream cipher I showed you last hour. So we will have some key K0. We take this key and some random input X0. And actually also some K1. So the initial state of our stream cipher will be 2 keys, K0 and K1, for the PRF, and some random input X0. Actually, the X0 does not even have to be secret. You can think of this as the first output of the stream cipher. And the construction goes as follows. In step I, you take Ki and Xi, and you output ki plus 2 and xi plus 1. So this is going to be x1. This is k1, this is going to be k3, this is x2. So not very nice, but you get the idea, right? So the important thing is k. So you already recognize this alternating structure as before, right? So if I output the key and the input, I'm going to use the input in the next round, but the key only in two rounds again later. So this will kind of ensure that there is some kind of independence between the xi's and the ki's. And you see, before we had like a PRG and an extractor, but now it's gone. And so why should this be a leakage resilient stream cipher? So in the last 5 minutes, let's kind of just recap this argument we did an hour ago. So what does it mean it's leakage resilient? It means that the output, let me recap the definition. It means that we want xi to be indistinguishable from uniform, given what? Given x1 up to xi minus 1, and leakage. So what was the leakage? Let's call this leakage 0. Yeah, let's call this leakage 0. So the adversary chooses some function f. And let's call this leakage lambda 0, and so on, right? So here he chooses lambda f2, he gets lambda 1, and so on. And the only assumptions we want to make about this function f, so first of all, this function f can be adaptively chosen in every step. So he chooses a function, he gets the leakage, he gets the next output xi, he chooses a leakage function fi plus 1, he gets the output of xi plus 1 on input xik, and so on. And what we want is that, say, even given, you know, assume this goes back like a million steps, even given this leakage here and like the million leakages before, this output here, x2, should be pseudo-random, you know, given all these previous outputs and all the previous leakages. Yeah, let's see. Yeah, so how should I call this? This should be lambda minus 1 or something. And this should be lambda.
Lambda 1. Bigger number. Not counted.
No, it's okay, right? Lambda 1 can compute x2. So it should be up to lambda I minus 2. Sorry. So the leakage up to the point where it's non-trivial, right? So let's see. It's minus 2, yeah. Because if you have lambda 1, you can actually compute x2. So, sorry, given lambda 1, yeah, exactly. Given everything up to this leakage, you know, which you can actually still, and x2, the next, yeah, exactly. The next output should be pseudo-random. And how does the proof go of the statement? So here we will use this, this square friendliness of weak PRFs. So assume we are like at this step, and assume that so far what we guaranteed is, let's call this xi and this ki. Assume you guaranteed that, so xi is uniformly random, ki has high min entropy, right? So ki has high min entropy. So ki has high min entropy. Has high min. I'm not going to write it up. So what I just got, because it's last 3 minutes, I'm just going to kind of try to sketch you the argument. What you're going to, so this is ki xi. So in the experiment, we do something as before. So we assume that this ki has high min entropy, and this xi is uniformly random. Then by the square friendliness of weak PRFs, so this is random, independent of the key k has high min entropy. So this is going to be pseudo-random. It's OK, pseudo-random. Now there is this leakage here, lambda I. So this is no longer pseudo-random, but it still has high min entropy. It has high Hill entropy, right? So at this point, you kind of do again the switch in the experiment. We replace these high Hill entropy variables with variables that have high min entropy, and we argue that these two games are indistinguishable. And then we have, you know, we're basically in the step as before. These variables have high min entropy, x2 is indistinguishable from the key k here, which was just high min entropy, and we can go on. So I actually cheated a bit because I only showed you that the square friendliness argument only shows that the output of a weak PRF has high min entropy if the key has high min entropy and the input is uniform. But in fact, it's sufficient if both input and key only have high min entropy and are independent. So parameters, of course, get worse. So that's, you know, and this very simple construction is really provably a provably secure stream cipher. Just using the square friendliness of the weak PRF. Okay. So I think we can stop 2 minutes early and, you know, happy to take any questions.